climate change isn't just an issue for future generations anymore, or for people or animals who live far away. It's already affecting us right here in the places where we live. And the more climate changes, the bigger the impacts we'll see. If you live in the Southern Great Plains, like I do, you know that this region has one of the most extreme climates in the entire United States. One day it could be over 80 degrees, and the next day it could be below freezing and snowing. One year we're in record drought, the next year we've got flood. All the Great Plains states are uniquely vulnerable to climate extremes, and Texas is, no surprise, number one. From 1980 to 2018, Texas racked up more than 105 weather and climate disasters that caused over $1 billion worth of damages. Some, like Hurricane Harvey, over $100 billion. We care about climate change because it takes our natural risks and it amplifies them. And in this region, we face a lot of them, from hurricanes and flooding to heat waves and drought. Water's a big deal here, and there's a lot of competition for it, from agricultural users to cities to even the energy sector. There's never enough water to go around, except when there's too much. And for some locations, climate change may be the final straw that breaks the camel's back. The hotter it gets, the more water we need, yet the less water we'll have. Especially if we're depending on surface reservoirs where evaporation increases with temperature. Across much of the region, we historically average just a week or two of days per year over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. But by end of century, even under a lower scenario where carbon emissions peak mid-century and then decline, this could increase by 3 to 5 weeks across the northern part of the region and a month or two across the southern. Remember that scorching summer of 2011? That could be the average summer by the end of the century under a lower scenario. Under a higher scenario, where carbon emissions continue to climb throughout the century, the increase would be much greater, from a month and a half in the most northern part of the region up to more than 3 months, a whole summer, in the south. As temperatures increase, my own research shows that our summer droughts will be getting stronger and more frequent. Natural patterns of feast and famine, flood and drought, are being amplified, with potentially devastating consequences for our economy. One study looking at the economic impacts of climate change across the U.S. found that the Southern Great Plains and the Southeastern states were the two most vulnerable regions, with projected GDP losses ranging from 5 up to 20% per county, much of it driven by decreases in agricultural yields. It isn't just about droughts, though. Because we don't expect much of a change in our average rainfall, this means that our heavy rainfall events are also increasing, especially across the eastern part of our region. What used to be considered a 500-year flood event in Houston, for example, happened in 2015 and 2016. And then, of course, there's the hurricanes. They're not getting more frequent, but they are getting stronger, they're intensifying faster, and, as we talk about in our Global Weirding episode on hurricanes, in a warmer world, they have a lot more rainfall associated with them. The rainfall from Hurricane Harvey caused yet another so-called 500-year event in 2017, including some $125 billion in damages. And it's estimated that as much as 40% of the rain that fell during Harvey would not have occurred if not for human-induced warming. Here in the Southern Great Plains, we're used to climate extremes, but we are not used to or anywhere near prepared for the way climate change is supersizing them. If you live in the Southwest, you know how important water is. Already there isn't enough to go around. Since 2000, for example, Lake Mead on the Colorado River has lost over 60% of its water due to ongoing drought combined with water use by cities and agriculture downstream. Water is the Southwest's Achilles heel, and this is exactly where climate change is hitting first. The Southwest has always been susceptible to mega droughts, as far back as tree ring records go. But as the world warms, these are intensifying, getting hotter and longer. California has experienced many droughts, so the one that began in 2011 was no surprise. But how long it lasted and how intense it got was surprising. And scientists found that was no accident. the record high temperatures that accompanied the drought were enhancing something they dubbed the ridiculously resilient ridge. In winter, this ridge would direct storm systems away from California, making the drought more intense. 2011 to 2014 was the driest period for California since record keeping began. Over 100 million trees died, hydroelectric power generation dropped by two-thirds, and the economic impacts averaged between $2 to $3 billion per year. The drought ended dramatically in the winter of 2016, which was also the wettest on record for Northern California. This rainfall was fueled by atmospheric rivers, which are also expected to intensify under climate change. These long, narrow streams of water are like rivers in the sky. They transport vast amounts of water vapor thousands of miles across the Pacific to land. Atmospheric rivers already account for 30 to 40% of the annual rainfall along the western U.S. coast. But the frequency and the severity of these events are projected to increase, because warmer temperatures increase evaporation, leading to higher levels of water vapor in the atmosphere. More water might sound like a good thing, but as the region warms, also more winter precipitation is going to be falling as rain and less as snow. This means less winter snowpack, which serves as a natural reservoir or storage for many states from Colorado to California. The snow falls in the winter, it builds up in the mountains, and then it begins to melt in spring just when it's needed for agriculture. But if the precipitation falls as rain instead of snow, it just washes away. So record low snowpack levels during warm winters, one-third below normal levels in Colorado in 2018, for example, have led to calls for reservoir building. But building reservoirs costs a lot more than relying on free snowpack. Wildfire is another key risk for the Southwest. As climate changes, hot and dry conditions are increasing the area burned by wildfires, as well as leading to a longer wildfire season overall. In New Mexico today, the wildfire season now lasts 7 months, compared to just 5 months 40 years ago. Around the LA area alone, wildfires have caused more than $3 billion worth of damage since 1990. Overall, it's estimated that the area burned by wildfire across the western U.S. since the mid-80s was twice what it would have been without climate change. Finally, the Southwest coastline is also affected by sea level rise and by ocean warming. At the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco, sea level has risen 9 inches or 22 centimeters since the 1850s. Ocean water acidity increased by 25 to 40%. And heat waves, such as the one that occurred from 2014 to 2016 during the California drought, have led to mass stranding of sick and starving birds and sea lions, as well as new species like red crabs and tuna actually moving north into the region. The bottom line is, we care about a changing climate because it's loading the dice against us. It's taking many of our naturally occurring risks and our pre-existing vulnerabilities, and it's making them worse in ways that affect us directly here and now. I live in West Texas, where the roads are long and straight. So straight that if you really wanted to, you could drive down the highway just looking in the rearview mirror. Until, that is, you hit a curve in the road. If you are not looking up ahead, you'll miss the curve and boom, you're off the road. What does this have to do with climate? The same principle applies. The information that we use to plan for our future is crucial. If we're relying on historical climate averages to determine future risks, we'll end up far from where we want it to be, unprepared for intense rainfall, record heat waves, or rising seas up ahead. No matter where we live, we're on the curve today. And what can we do about it? We need to prepare, to build resilience to the risks that we can't avoid, and, as I discuss in many other Global Weirding episodes, to reduce our emissions of heat-trapping gases to avoid the risks that we can. The U.S. National Climate Assessment is one important resource that helps us look ahead down that road. Please check out nca2018.globalchange.gov for more valuable information on how climate is changing in the places where you live, and what we can do to prepare. Thanks for watching Global Weirding.
This episode was brought to you in part by Citizens Climate Lobby. If you have any questions about climate versus weather, let us know during one of our Facebook Live Q&As. And please be sure to check out globalweirdingseries.com for more episodes. See you next time.